HR Success Talk is an HR platform for HR professionals, managers at all levels, representative of top management, and students to share their knowledge that they have acquired from their experiences with others and at the same time from their peers as well. HR Success Talk also engages in knowledge sharing through blogs on various HR related aspects, for example, performance management, training and development, human resource information system, and health safety. Now I would like to invite Ms. Deepthi on the dais to please give us the interview.
My name is Deepthi. So now I would like to introduce HR Success Talk. It's a network of HR, by HR and for HR. Basically, it's a growing HR community. We have our website by the name of www.hrsuccesstalk.com. It is founded in the year 2013 and currently we have 17,000 plus members in our platform. This is a platform where the HR experts share their expertise, case studies and articles in the form of different contents. It's like, this is a global website and we have a forum also. This is but the objective of this platform is to, you know, provide and spread the awareness about the HRs. We have our digital presence in the HR forum, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter and YouTube. This is our Facebook page. You guys can visit and like our page. So to get updated about our HR events, this is our Twitter handle. This is our YouTube channel. On our YouTube channel, you can watch the video interviews of various HR leaders on different HR topics. This is our HR forum. You can visit and log in yourself and you can ask your HR related queries there. Thank you.
Now I would like to invite Dean School of Management, Professor Vishal Talwar on the stage to give the welcome address.
All right, good morning everyone. I think we're already running against time, so I'll try and keep this short. I'm a true academic, so I love to talk. But I'll try and keep this as concise as possible. It's an absolute pleasure for our young university to be a part of the HR Success Talk network. A young, dynamic university like ours, it's very important for us to reach out. It's very important for us to be able to demonstrate how different we are, not only in terms of the infrastructure that we provide, but also in terms of the kind of education that we are and intend to have, you know, from a longer term perspective. Whether it's experiential learning, whether it's immersive learning, whether it's increased levels of employability, for any of this to succeed in a world where we really don't know what jobs will exist in the future, we really don't know how we have to engage with our employees. We are very different generations trying to talk to each other. Okay, so whether it's Generation X, whether it's Generation Y, whether it's Generation Z, all these generations have a different way of going about things. All these generations have a different way of how engagement is defined, of how automation might affect, you know, your jobs in the future, how we try and motivate employees in the longer term, how we motivated employees from Generation X and Y is rather different to how we'll motivate employees from Generation, the millennials, if I can call it. And thus it is important for us to know as a university, and it is more importantly it's for you as students to know how and what is it that we should be doing in the longer term, right? So obviously for that particular reason, a lot of the insight of people who've been there, done that, insight of people who have you know, made sure organizations stand on the basis of the employee potential or employee capital, we need to know a lot of all this. We need to start much earlier in life, whether it is BTech students, whether it is MBA students, whether it is BBA students, it doesn't really matter. Finally, you will be part of a workforce of the future. Some of you will be consuming jobs, some of you will be producing jobs. But it is important for us to know what will make us tick in an organization in the future, right? So thank you very much to all the guests. It's an absolute pleasure. Mr. Jaina, thank you very much for coming along here. Mr. Raishi Biswas, Mr. Govind Negi as well, Ms. Saloni Kaul, Mr. Himanshu Singla, and of course we'll have a number of guests in the afternoon as well. Ms. Arindam Chakravarti, Mr. Arijit Chakravarti, Mr. Abhay Kapoor, Ms. Shalini Kothiyal, and of course, thank you very much, Ms. Deepthi, for giving us an introduction to what HR Success Talk is all about. Thank you to all the organizers beforehand to make this particular event successful. Without any further ado, I think we should, you know, set the ball rolling and start the entire proceedings. Thank you. Thank you very much. Welcome.
With this, I would like to put your hands together for the first speaker for today, Mr. Jitendra K. Jena, who will be giving us insights to the age, HR in the age of AI, which is artificial intelligence. Mr. Jena is a leading figure in human resource management, who has designed the framework for and implemented talent management processes in a number of leading organizations. He has diverse set of skills and has been in the industry for 19 years. Please put your hands together. We would like to call upon Mr. Jena.
Good morning. All at a time, once more. Good morning. How many of you believe the success of a community, country, or an organization depends on the quality of its people? Would you please raise your hand? Good. Could you please tell me what you mean by quality of people? Can anybody attempt? What do you mean by quality of people? Character, integrity, value system, behavior, and attitude. But in HR, knowledge, skill, and attitude comprises of the quality of employees. 19.39% of Indian companies started TQM in early 90s. Only 0.97% were successful. What was the cause? The cause was TQM is not possible without TQP, total quality people. Character, integrity, value system, behavior, and attitude. Behaviors are changing. I think we must be observing the new generation coming in, their behavior is quite open. Before getting into discussing about the new generation, I would like to ask you a question. Where do you see HR tomorrow? You all young guys, you must have a lot of ideas. Would you please tell me? We are oldies. So would you please tell me, where do you see HR tomorrow? Where do you see HR tomorrow? Anybody? You see HR blooming? You see HR drowning? You see HR getting a pick? Oh, where do you see HR? Where do you see HR tomorrow?
I actually see HR growing. Moving
to globally integrated economies, and there'll be more of creative thinkers coming up. And handling creative people is a difficult task. So I believe the function of HR will actually increase instead of job. Thank you. I'm both pessimistic and optimistic about the future of HR. I'm optimistic because you are born in an age where everything is easy. You have a lot of access to technology, you have a lot of access to data system, application. So HR is going through a transformation. And if you frame yourself in the age of transformation, you are going to leave the flag. But on the other side, I'm very much pessimistic. Because the current generation in HR, those who are practicing HR, experts are predicting 40% jobs are going to be lost by 2020. I'm not saying 10 years ahead, I'm not saying 5 years ahead, 2020, 40% jobs will be lost minimum. So I don't want to give a picture which is folly. I don't want to give you a picture which is, you know, just looking like golden zero. I want to give you a picture. Guys, get ready. What is needed to be employable in the industry. Three megatrend change happening in the industry. Now, what are the changes that are happening in the industry? First is behaviors are changing. The new set of people coming in, they're very open. Their behavior are changing. They're very collaborative. And they have two identities. One is their physical identity, and another is their digital identity. In their digital identity, they collaborate each other, get connected to any part of the world, and they share opinion and ideas. In their digital identity, they share their problems and they get solution in their social circle. Now people are now talking a lot of things through LinkedIn, a lot of things through Facebook, and they take their own, they solve their own problem. That is why these people, they don't follow law and order, command and control. They don't follow the hierarchy. They don't want to, fit themselves into the hierarchical system of companies. The second megatrend change is a change in place of work. And third one is the technology changes. I'll show you. Now, if you see, this is generally the workplace we used to, when we were young, we used to find this kind of workplace. Now, in our, when we were young, when we were management training, the concept of where you join, whichever place you join, used to call work. But now, that is changed. Now, where you join is, the place is not work. Now, what you do is called work, from where you do, and when you do, that doesn't matter. So, there are a lot of companies, they are doing research on workplace culture. They are doing research that from where employee will be performing. Now see the new work culture, the new office cultures. This is a Google office, this is a Accenture office. Now you see the difference. Now companies are thinking that how you will unbox your capabilities, how you will generate ideas more and more, and how you will add value to the product and services of different companies. So there is a workplace change that is happening. Now there are a lot of technology changes happening. There are four types of technology changes that is happening. Now, first technology change that is happening is called access. Now, you have access to information, and you have access to database, you have access to applications, you have access to social sector, you have access to technology. So, nowadays, people, they're enjoying solving their own problem. So nowadays, consultants are going idle day by day. Now, we used to follow road method of learning when we were young, when we were in school, or when we were in college. Now, the education system was forcing, or the education system was being constructed in such a way that how you can acquire more and more knowledge. My favorite subject was geography in school, and my favorite teacher was also geography teacher, and she used to tell me how to remember history with the help of geography. I used to teach my young daughter the same concept, that how you can remember history with the help of geography. And she said, "Dad, your days are gone. Google auntie can give me the better information than you, so your days are gone." Now, what exactly is happening now? Acquiring knowledge, the process of acquiring knowledge is gone. You have everything on the laptop, you have everything on the phone, right? Now, the importance is delivering knowledge has been more important than acquiring knowledge. So people are more concerned about delivering knowledge rather than acquiring knowledge. These people, the young people, the young generation, those who are coming to office, they want to solve their own problem. They want to call themselves as experts. They don't want to, you know, go to the consultant because they want to create something new, and that is good. Now, artificial intelligence. Now, artificial intelligence is going to transform in big way the HR process and HR activities. Now, for example, you know, Google Translator. So Google has come in a big way with Google Translator. Watson has introduced Watson Insight. And there are many companies, they have automated their repetitive transaction process. Oracle has started Workbook and Workplace. And I'll give you an example, IBM Watson. Now, IBM Watson is an audit process that you know, KPMG has started recently, just 2 months back. Now, the machine is trained for 40 minutes, the machine will give 73% accuracy. The machine, if machine will be trained for 2 days, the machine will be giving 98% accuracy in audit, right? One machine can replace 26 people a day. So you can imagine, so there is a prediction, 38,000 chartered accountants, those who are doing you know, audit work, they're going to be jobless.
Thank you.
Your meeting with Jane is at 9:30. I put the coffee on.
She can interface with household devices. And she's also a personal stylist.
What do you think?
Why don't you try the blue tie with it?
Good idea.
She's your world-class office assistant, using artificial intelligence algorithms to analyze data quickly and efficiently.
We plan to run a marketing campaign on the Upper East Side of New York. What do you think about that neighborhood?
This neighborhood has a very promising outlook for this campaign, with 25,000 housing units. Also, 82% of people living there have a college degree.
I think that's the right one for us.
Sorry to interrupt, guys. Thomas has a lunch date with Chloe in 15 minutes. She just posted a bunch of photos on Facebook about her trip to New York.
Thank you.
I just sent the meeting notes to you and Thomas.
As well as your support when you're at your most creative.
Hey, I ordered those paints that you asked for. Also, for lunch, I ordered you some falafel from your favorite restaurant.
You're the best.
She can also be a hands-free helper around the house.
Hey, need some help in here?
Could you pull up a recipe for chicken curry, please?
I'll walk you through it step by step.
Thanks.
First, you cut the chicken into cubes.
She's even a personal security guard.
Watch the house, okay?
Able to monitor your home and your energy costs while providing peace of mind with real-time video feeds of every room of your home. She can connect you across the globe to be with your family.
Hey guys, how are you guys doing?
We wish you were here.
Did you have fun at work?
She can be the life of the party, playing music through internal speakers and photographing moments that will last a lifetime.
Hey guys, let's take a picture of everyone. Smile. One, two, three.
Now, I'll tell you how it works. Suppose you want to buy a car. So when you want to buy a car, you have to try a car, right? So you go to, one day you go to Mog, one day you have to go to Audi, or another day you can go to BMW and you drive and you test the car. But in augmented reality platform, you get into a booth. Within an hour, you get to understand and you get to select a car and take a decision. Doctors are doing operation. They are going to do the operation, you know, putting the augmented reality glass on where they can scan the human body then and there They can connect to the other doctors sitting there in the other part of the world, and they can take an instant decision over there. Not only that, you know, airline industries, the aircraft maintenance, thousands, say, you know, crores of people are there working for aircraft maintenance. The entire industry is going to be driven by robots, by augmented reality. Now, there's another industry coming, which is logistics industry. You know, you have to do a lot of, you know, locational definition for where you have kept this product or that product. Now, augmented reality will help you to find out the product without anybody. So you can imagine, not only HR, all the operation jobs are going to jeopardized over years time. In an augmented reality platform, you can take a decision on the basis of experience. And also, AR helps learning of complex skills on the job.
Microsoft HoloLens brings holograms into your real world. Using transparent lenses, spatial sound, and an understanding of your environment, holograms look and sound like they're actually part of the world around you. That is mixed reality. With Microsoft HoloLens, holograms are viewed through the holographic frame centered in the middle of your view. This preserves your peripheral vision, so you can move freely and connect and collaborate with the people around you. Holograms in mixed reality don't block out what you can see and hear. This enables you to engage with digital content and tools alongside the objects in your real world. Holograms can be world-locked in a physical location, so you can walk around them, or they can travel with you. You can even hear them in 3D with spatial sound. Microsoft HoloLens is the world's first fully untethered, self-contained holographic computer. With the mixed reality experience of HoloLens, you can stay in the real world.
All in a system that provides good vision of your surroundings and enhances the way you work. The Vuzix M3000 works like a smartphone or tablet, but hands-free. Its temple contains a touch-sensitive surface that works like a trackpad control, or you can speak your commands for a truly hands-free experience.
Open the project schedule and cap plans for 435 Laurel.
Because it's Android, the Vuzix M3000 runs thousands of existing apps.
Ready to dig? Hang on, let me check something.
The M3000 has built-in GPS, so it always knows where you are and it tracks your head movements and viewing angle for unprecedented awareness of what you're doing and seeing, whether it's real or virtual or both.
Looks okay. The city water line runs over there. As long as you keep away from that, you're good.
With the M3000's camera, you can share what you see with others in real time.
Next step, that's three. Where's the fourth screw? Call support.
This opens up new possibilities in remote service and repair, remote monitoring, even remote telemedicine applications.
It looks like you haven't removed the access panel. That was...
Mr. Admin, I need a replacement RDR3450 as soon as possible.
Intelligent wayfinding and light guiding is only one of many possible applications that shorten training time and virtually eliminate error in warehousing and other industries.
So the skylight is really dramatic.
No.
Want to see?
No.
Yeah. See all the dimensions.
Good, look what I made.
making life easier. If you are in office, you are at home, IoT is going to make your life very, very easy. IoT is used for workforce analytics. So whatever you are doing, you know, employee data system, HRIS, it's going to be taken care by IoT, and it is at a very, very nominal cost. Attendance tracking. If you are a multinational company, you have 10 offices all over the world, they can connect, and they, through sensors and internet, they will do the attendance tracking, information sharing, and online tracking and positioning of the products. Now IoT is going to replace the entire service sector, be it the services of automatic home appliances, be it the services of services, not products, services of the pneumatic engineer, your data center, manual data center, your filing system, and those who are employed for record keeping, they are going to be replaced. And this industry is changing at a very fast speed. If you look at, if you just think about Steve Jobs, what he has done, only Apple iPhone has replaced five industries, thousands of companies. Now, earlier you had, CPU-based computer, right? Just 8-9 years back, right? That has been replaced by laptops. You had big routers that has been replaced by inbuilt Wi-Fi system, right? You have, you had email, you had pager, that has been replaced again. Messages and your Android. Now, if you see, even your laptop is, or your mobile phone has been modified to communicator, and that has been replaced. Then you got, the smartphone, and now smartphone has replaced the entire peripheral industries, the entire competitive industries. Now I'm going to ask you, the way technology is changing, are we changing in the same way? Would you please raise your hand? Are we? We are taking the excess of technology, but we are not, hands-on in technology, or you are not applying technology everywhere. Now the IoT video I have showed you, that IoT is already started in Canberra, in Kansas, and in Queensland. So just think, this industry is going to replace how many jobs? If you look at today and pre-industrial revolution, what happened? Everything was called bottle trade, where everything was custom built. So industrial revolution came in, and it came into a phase where it was called mass consumption society. So we became a part of mass consumption society. And mass consumption society standardized everything. If you have a car, one car. If you have a shirt, one shirt. If you have a trouser, one trouser. This means if you have a car, only black car. If you have a shirt, only black shirt. If you have a shirt, only white shirt. If you have a trouser, only black trouser. If you have a coat, only black coat. When Henry Ford started this mass commoditization through his factory, he said, we, you know, develop all colors, but all colors are black. You know, all Ford cars till 70s or till 80s, early 80s, all were black. Now, this mass consumption society was, or the mass commoditization was very boring. Augmented reality coming in, analyst coming in, you know, internet of time coming in, internet of things coming in, you know, new ideas came in, and customer wanted, why don't you customize our product? Now, you know, cars are also being customized as per your needs. Limousines are being customized, caravans are being customized, helicopters are being customized, even lower segment cars are also being customized. Now, customer is saying, if you have so much of knowledge, why don't you apply your knowledge and give me customized product? Now, HR function has been designed around the mass commoditization. HR function has not been designed for the transformation which is happening right now. Now, is it boring? Okay. Now, you know, the same HR system which was running 20, 30 years back, in same HR system is run, even though industry is going through a lot of transformation. So HR need an urgent transformation. And what this transformation is going to impact, whatever operation job you people are going to do, that's going to be finished. All the operation jobs are going to be taken care of by robotics. If you are doing attendance integration, payroll, you know, accounting, you are doing auditing, you are doing APAR, accounts payable, account receivable, I think anybody from finance background? No. I think even other marketing people should be here today, because it's applicable everywhere, all the operation. So all the operation jobs are going to be finished. Now you ask me a question, then what will do? You people are born in a age, you are blessed. Why you are blessed? Because the transformation is coming in, and you can get into that transformation, you can build in different modalities of transformation. I'll tell you, you know, even now, do you ever get a letter that somebody has written by hand? Young guys, I'm asking you.
No.
But you should not forget, there is a touch in that. You know, whenever you go and join an organization, even your CEO gives you a recognition certificate, or best employee award, and the signature is by pen, that touches your heart. So you should not forget, all these are managing. So delete this word managing from your dictionary. Going forward, you are not going to manage. You know what is the meaning of managing? Managing is a French word, means taking horse into submission. So you are not going to do managing jobs. You are going to do enabling, facilitating, encouraging, and motivating. Now you will say, you know, nowadays nobody motivates nobody. You need to understand how to motivate. You have to create a workplace where people feel like thinking. Now I'll ask a question. Most of our people that go to a temple or a bus on Sunday and pay for it, and they feel happy about it. The next day, Monday, They come to office for which they're paid. But they feel bad about it. Why? Why? Guys, if you are not going to question my answer, if you're not becoming participative, then I'm going to close this within 2 minutes. It's a mental pressure, you're right. It's a mental pressure. So you people think how you can release the pressure. Creating filler-based work culture. Now, what is a filler-based work culture? Now, along with work, you need to have some fillers, icebreakers, some movies. Now, you people, you are going to join in an era where there is no directing, everything is flat, where there is open work culture. You can work from office. You know, there are many companies that started this culture. The employee can work from home. Employee can work from coffee shop. Employee can work from CVHS. Employee can work from, restaurants. So these days are changing, but the policies, practices, and systems in HRs are not changing. So you people are going to be the flag bearer of the transformation of the system, techniques, hierarchy, everything. So apply your mind. Now, if you are reading the theories just for the knowledge sake, you read it. Now, knowledge is available everywhere, right? Now, you need to understand that how you are going to apply it. So what you do is better you go to companies, visit companies, take some project that how workplace transformation is happening, how structural transformation is happening, how process transformation is happening. You cannot follow the same process because all the process that has been built around the mass commoditization has been obsolete now, and it's going to be fully obsolete by 3-4 years or maximum by 5 years. Can I ask you this question? This is a very burning question. How many HR professionals are successful CEOs? Or can I ask you this question again? How many HR professionals make their career as a CEO? CEOs are taken from the organization, from inside the organization. Why HR people are not, I'm not blaming HR, but why HR people are not there in the CEO desk? Can throw some kind of answer, whatever comes to your mind. Anybody? Yeah, definitely. There's $1 million answer they don't want. Yes, I would tell you, it's a little bitter to test Kudwal Sachin. HR is intellectually lazy. I'm from the same fraternity. And I'm sorry to say, HR is intellectually lazy. Why lazy? If technology can transform day by day, why can't HR transform? I know many guys, they enjoy doing their, operation job, sitting with friends, chit-chatting, and, having beer, and for years and years, they're doing nothing, only operation. Now, when this world is changing in a fast space, and if HR people are doing the same kind of operation which was built around 70 years back, do you think it's going to sustain? So I am also from the same community. I'm also going to take, I think somebody is drowsing. So I think it's a dull topic. Okay, let me try and crack a joke. you'd like to... You'd like to listen, look, joke?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm not good at cracking joke. One fine morning, one young executive was flying. Next to him was a lady. The young executive, again and again, staring at that lady. The young lady asked, "Hey, why are you staring at me?" And he said, "Excuse me, ma'am, why are you wearing this wedding band in the wrong finger? Oh, you don't know? I married the wrong man. Make sure that you are in the right room." You know, we have a habit of saying this. You know, I am in this university, what can I expect? These people are like this. I am in this company, what can I expect? The standard is like this. So, forget about that era. Come out of that era. I was hired by a multinational company to hire a CHRO, a president HR. I asked some question from HR. I asked very simple question. So, what do you mean by HR business plan? I said, he is from IIM. And he said, I was never taught. I said, doesn't matter. Have you never thought about it? He said, no, I have never practiced it. If you are going to follow this same, you are going to lose your job. Or you are not going to get a job. Think beyond. Connect it. What is happening in industry? Connect it. What is happening in other profession? And borrow. And then only you can generate new processes. See, world is not going to wait for you. You have to work in the same speed the world is running. No, I asked you a question, I didn't get the answer. How many HR professionals are successful CEOs? As I told you, that these people are intellectually lazy, and most of the HR people, what they do, you know, even they get a chance to sit in the executive body meeting or the management meeting, you know, they escape. And those who got into the meeting, those who make their, you know, position comfortable, they are the CEOs. Now, HR is away from business process. Now, if you don't know what is happening around the business, how can you going to, how can you start a new process? So you have to be, now, let me tell you, there are many people, they are working in Lufthansa, there are many people, they are working in HP, there are many people, they are working in HR people, they are working in, say, IBM. Now, the automated industry, let's forget about the automated industry, those engineering industry. If you ask about the engineering concept to HR guy, you'll say, you know, it's an engineering concept. I'm not concerned about it. You have to be concerned today. You have to be concerned. Now, I'm going to tell you another thing. Now, whatever you are reading right now is going to help you only 30%. Please go to companies, see how they are working, and do a lot of projects. And I would request the professors, please give them more projects. Go and work on projects on transformation, because transformation era is going to come. So work on work culture transformation, strategic transformation, you know, functional transformation, work on, structural transformation. Now forget about the operation. The operation jobs are going to be eaten by robots. HR is not ready to transform. So you new generation coming in, if you are going to lift the flag, the success is yours. You know, what is the need today? World needs 60% CEOs from HR. Or the industry needs 60% CEOs from HR. Because the HR bent of mind has been developed. But if you people will be only on operation, then you are not going to win the war. When I talk to HR community, I'm reminded that I met a person years back in New York. Can you tell me if anybody has gone to US or New York must be knowing what is this? Can you tell me? This is the head office of Kodak. Kodak as a company became obsolete. I met the CEO and I asked, when you got to know that company is going to be obsolete? He said, I got to know the company is going to be obsolete before 10 years that we become obsolete. I said, if you got to know 10 years, why didn't you do something to reviving of the company? Because, you know, these people, they are masters in colors. Now, we had our Kodak moment of life. You know, all professors or your parents must be having Kodak moment of life. They're pioneer in Kodak color films. But they could not grab digital photography or digital colors. They could fail. Now I asked, if you got to know for 10 years, why you didn't do anything? He said, you know, we were not alone. We were a group, became obsolete, and we were part of that. And luckily and unluckily, I'm into a fraternity here where I'm a part of, guest consulting group of McKinsey, and McKinsey was giving them the consultancy. And I later met the McKinsey people, and I asked, why didn't you do something for the company when you were doing consultancy? They said they had a mindset. They didn't want to change. So HR has a mindset. I'll tell you, you people can boost up the morale of the promoter. You people can facilitate the promoter to create some magic, because you people are made for that. You people are the custodian of the business. Now, in India, I got to meet another person in a seminar who is a CFO of Fuji Films. Now, Fuji is again a world company. They had the same kind of technology like Kodak. Now, what Fuji did? Fuji used the same line in, you know, making face creams for ladies. And they're a very profitable company today. Now, in the same seminar, I met a person, a CHRO of Canon. And I asked, you know, you are from a AS where Kodak, Fuji, all this brand belongs to. So they became obsolete on their core competence. Why didn't you? And he said, see, we know our future. We know what we are going today to, what we are going to do tomorrow. We know what development we are going to do tomorrow, and we know what tomorrow's customer is going to expect. And we do value engineering, they were, but they didn't. That is why they are pioneer today. But Canon is much more younger than Fujifilm and Kodak. Now the transformation you see Your role is managing, aggregating, and using command and control. Right? What action you are doing? Managing, controlling, aggregating. All these are operational jobs. Now future is, this is entirely going to be obsolete. Future is role of transformational leaders, inspiring. And action oriented, you must be telling why always this person is saying inspiring, inspirational leader. It's very theoretical, isn't it? Isn't it? It's theoretical, but not. It's not theoretical. Your outcome will be smart, specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and time-bound. Every activities of HR going forward will be smart. So you have to be very sure what we are going to do. Set hierarchy. Now you people, you are going to join in an era where there is no hierarchy, everything is flat, where there is open work culture. You can work from office. You know, there are many companies that started this culture. The employee can work from home, employee can work from coffee shop, employee can work from CVHS, employee can work from restaurants. So these days are changing, but the policies, practices, and systems in HRs are not changing. So you people are going to be the flag bearer of the transformation of the system, techniques, hierarchy, everything. So apply your mind. Now, if you are reading the theories just for the knowledge sake, you read it. Now, knowledge is available everywhere, right? Now, you need to understand that how you are going to apply it. So what you do is better you go to companies, visit companies, take some project that how workplace transformation is happening, how structural transformation is happening, how process transformation is happening. You cannot follow the same process because all the process that has been built around the mass commoditization has been obsolete now, and it's going to be fully obsolete by 3-4 years or maximum by 5 years. Can I ask you this question? This is a very burning question. How many HR professionals are successful CEOs? Or can I ask you this question again? How many HR professionals make their career as a CEO? CEOs are taken from the organization, from inside the organization. Why HR people are not, I'm not blaming HR, but why HR people are not there in the CEO desk? Can throw some kind of answer, whatever comes to your mind. Anybody? Yeah, definitely. There's a $1 million answer they don't want. Yes. I will tell you, it's a little bitter to test good one such. HR is intellectually lazy. I'm from the same fraternity. And I'm sorry to say, HR is intellectually lazy. Why lazy? If technology can transform day by day, why can't HR transform? I know many guys, they enjoy doing their, operation job, sitting with friends, chit-chatting, and, having a beer, and for years and years, they're doing nothing, only operation. Now, when this world is changing in a fast space, and if HR people are doing the same kind of operation which was built around 70 years back, do you think it's going to sustain? So I'm also from the same community. I'm also going to tech. I think somebody is drowsing. So it is it? I think it's a dull topic. Okay. Let me try and crack a joke. You would like to listen, look, joke?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm not good at cracking joke. One fine morning, young executive was flying. Next to him was a lady. The young executive, again and again, staring at that lady. The young lady asked, "Hey, why are you staring at me?" And he said, "Excuse me, ma'am, why are you wearing this wedding band in the wrong finger?" "Oh, you don't know? I married the wrong man." "Make sure that you are in the right room." You know, we have a habit of saying this. You know, I am in this university, what can I expect? These people are like this. I am in this company, what can I expect? The standard is like this. So, forget about that era. Come out of that era. I was hired by a multinational company to hire a CHRO, a president HR. I asked some question from HR. I asked a very simple question. So, what do you mean by HR business plan? I said, he is from IIM. And he said, "I was never taught." I said, "Doesn't matter. Have you never thought about it?" He said, "No, I have never practiced it." If you are going to follow this same, you are going to lose your job. Or you are not going to get a job. Think beyond. Connect it what is happening in industry. Connect it what is happening in other professions. And borrow. And then only you can generate new processes. See, world is not going to wait for you. You have to walk in the same speed the world is running. Now, I asked you a question, I didn't get the answer. How many HR professionals are successful CEOs? As I told you, that these people are intellectually lazy, and most of the HR people, what they do, you know, even they get a chance to sit in the executive body meeting or the management meeting, you know, they escape. And those who got into the meeting, those who make their, you know, position comfortable, they are the CEOs. Now, HR is away from business process. Now, if you don't know what is happening around the business, how can you how can you start a new process? So you have to be. Now, let me tell you, there are many people that are working in Lufthansa, there are many people that are working in HP, there are many people that are working in HR people, they are working in, say, IBM. Now, the automated industry, let's forget about the automated industry, because the engineering industry, if you ask about the engineering concept to HR guy, you'll say, you know, it's an engineering concept. I'm not concerned about it. You have to be concerned today. You have to be concerned. Now, I'm going to tell you another thing. Now, whatever you are reading right now is going to help you only 30%. Please go to companies, see how they are working, and do a lot of projects. And I would request the professors, please give them more projects. Go and work on projects on transformation, because transformation era is going to come. So work on work culture transformation, strategic transformation, you know, functional transformation, work on, structural transformation. Now forget about the operation. The operation jobs are going to be eaten by robots. HR is not ready to transform. So you new generation coming in, if you are going to lift the flag, the success is yours. You know, what is the need today? World needs 60% CEOs from HR. Or the industry needs 60% CEOs from HR. Because the HR bent of mind has been developed. But if you people will be only on operation, then you are not going to win the war. When I talk to HR community, I'm reminded that I met a person years back in New York. Can you tell me if anybody has gone to US or New York must be knowing what is this? Can you tell me? This is the head office of Kodak. Kodak as a company became obsolete. I met the CEO and I asked, when you got to know that company is going to be obsolete? He said, I got to know the company is going to be obsolete before 10 years that we become obsolete. I said, if you got to know 10 years, why didn't you do something to reviving of the company? Because, you know, these people, they are masters in colors. Now, we had our Kodak moment of life. You know, all professors or your parents must be having Kodak moment of life. They are pioneer in Kodak color films. But they could not grab digital photography or digital colors. They could fail. Now I asked, if you got to know for 10 years, why you didn't do anything? He said, you know, we were not alone. We were a group, became obsolete, and we were part of that. And luckily and unluckily, I'm into a fraternity here where I'm a part of, guest consulting group of McKinsey, and McKinsey was giving them the consultancy. And I later met the McKinsey people, and I asked, why didn't you do something for the company when you were doing consultancy? They said they had a mindset. They didn't want to change. So HR has a mindset. I'll tell you, you people can boost up the morale of the promoter. You people can facilitate the promoter to create some magic, because you people are made for that. You people are the custodian of the business. Now, in India, I got to meet another person in a seminar who is a CFO of Fuji Films. Now, Fuji is again a world company. They had the same kind of technology like Kodak. Now, what Fuji did? Fuji used the same line in, you know, making face creams for ladies. And they're a very profitable company today. Now, in the same seminar, I met a person, a CHRO of Canon. And I asked, you know, you are from a AS where Kodak, Fuji, all this brand belongs to. So they became obsolete on their core competence. Why didn't you? And he said, see, we know our future. We know what we are going today to what we are going to do tomorrow. We know what development we are going to do tomorrow, and we know what tomorrow's customer is going to expect. And we do value engineering, they were, but they didn't. That is why they are pioneer today. But Canon is much more younger than Fujifilm and cut up. Now the transformation you see, your role is managing, aggregating, and using command and control. Right? What action you are doing? Managing, controlling, aggregating. All these are operational jobs. Now future is, this is entirely going to be obsolete. Future is role of transformational leaders, inspiring. And action oriented, you must be telling, why always this person is saying inspiring, inspirational leader? It's very theoretical, isn't it? Isn't it? It's theoretical, not. It's not theoretical. Your outcome will be smart, specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and time-bound. Every activities of HR going forward will be smart. So you have to be very sure what we are going to do. Influencing, organizing, facilitating, and inspiring. You have to create that atmosphere where person can think. You know, under pressure, the new generation is not going to perform. So you have to facilitate them, you have to inspire them, and you have to make them a purpose to grow. Now, you see this, have you ever experienced that a bulb gets brushed? Kyun hota hai? Padta kyun hai? High voltage, the energy comes in, high energy. I translate it into different thing, which is called capability. I'll tell you a story. A young executive came back to his home with full of office tasks. His 4-year-old son wanted to play with his father. He said, Dad, I want to play with you. And Dad said, oh my dear son, I'm extremely busy today. I have a lot of pending works. So I cannot give you time. Would you please go to your mom and play with her? So no, my dear dad, I want to play with you, no matter how busy you are. And he started changing again and again, again and again. The father became irritated. He saw in the corner of the room, there is a magazine. And last page of that magazine was a picture of a woman. He tore it into so many hundred pieces, and he said, oh my dear son, would you please come here? There is a big game for you. The son came and he said, what's that? He said, son, see, this is a walnut. I poured it into so many hundred pieces. Can you please rearrange it? If you do this, I will play with you entire night, no matter how busy I am. And he went back to his laptop. He started laughing at the kid. He said, he is gone. Even if it could be done, it would be taking 3 days, not less than that. After 5 minutes, the kid came. Hey, Dad, I could do it. I'm done. He said, you could do it? How? He said, would you please come and see? He went and saw it was done. He said, oh, my dear son, would you please tell me how could you do it? Son said, Dad, do you want to learn it from me? I said, yes, tell me. He said, Dad, it's so simple. The opposite side of the world map was a picture of a man. I collected the picture together, turned it the other way, it became world map. You cannot measure human capability. You cannot question human capability. But you can develop an atmosphere where human capability will boost it, will flourish. You know, who knows, the Wright brothers would make aeroplane. because they could think. Who knows that, who knew that Sir Isaac Newton could discover so big things about, center of gravity, because he could think. You have to create a platform for your employees. You have to create a culture for your employees where they can think. You have to start with filler-based work culture. You have to give them training. You have to make a learning-oriented culture. You have to show them a future that, hey, after 3 years, you are going to see yourself. Today, if you say somebody, after 10 years, you're going to see yourself as a general manager, nobody believes. Today, you know, you have to show them this sector path, how soon he can grow fast, right? So you have to show them career, you have to show them future. Not only this, you have to transform the vision into objectives, objectives into key result areas. So, as I told you, it's great opportunity for you, but you know, you have to think how you're going to start. If you are going with the same, you know, employee life cycle, you are going with the same, Excel sheet, analysis or attendance integration, payroll integration, you know, your job is going to be taken away within 2 years. So you have to think.
So, don't you think that this transcends the function of HR? I mean, instead of focusing on what HR should do, it's more about how, what kind of people should be going into HR now.
Absolutely right. You need to get that vision where the track is going. Now, you need to understand how technology is growing and what will be the need of technology for us tomorrow. So thinking tomorrow, you design the process today. You are definitely going to do it for people because people are going to give you service and product. If you are following the outdated, you are following the same, monotonous, fashion of work, you're not going to satisfy your customers. So who are your customers? If you are going to join industries, who will be your customer? You all. Who will be your customer?
Depends on the industry.
Even your boss is your customer. Even your other finance department is your customer. Even marketing department is your customer. They are your immediate customers. Because you people are working for them.
You'll have stuff like IoT. You'll have stuff like, not AI. AI is the other track. But you'll have tools which will aid HR, right, to be more effective. And then you have tools like artificial intelligence which will completely replace HR, right? So I don't think you've delineated that aspect very clearly.
First of all, you said people are thinking of application. First, try to understand what is your role in the industry. Your role is, first role is enabling, making, facilitating. And your role is not managing. Now, you are thinking something that technology is going in a speed of 1,000 km/h, and I will overset that. It's not possible. Now, if you are thinking that I'll go ahead of technology, you have to be parallel with technology. You have to support technology, but you have to create your position along with technology. If you say no, over this technology, I'll create some other technology which will grab this technology and I'll rule open. That's not going to be possible. You understand my point? So somewhere when you start, you have to go out of your mindset that I'm here to enable, I'm here to facilitate. I'm here to organize, and I'm here to facilitate others to work for the success. You are not a driver. You are not, you know, a technician. You are not an engineer. You are a facilitator because you are from HR. You are not responsible for one activity. You are responsible. You are responsible for failure and success of the entire organization. I am coming to the other part of the story. Now I told you about the behavior. Now I'm coming to the other part, which is smart. Give me some time, then I'll go to the smarter part, which is specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and time bound. Now, what is your main, you as HR people, what is your main objective? How you fulfill the aspiration, because everybody has different aspirations. Now you have to connect aspirations with business goal. You have to connect aspiration with purpose. Then only you can enable and you can facilitate employees to do something. Now, there is a big question. Now where I think the discussion is revolving around. Now, what is that smart work you people are going to do? First is, you know, you have a goal of life, right? Now how that goal is congruating with organization goal. First is you have to break the vision into goal, functional goal or functional strategies, and translate strategies into you know, objectives, and objectives into key result areas, which is the biggest challenge of HR people. Even if you go to many companies, you know, all the people or all the employees, they must not be in their KRS, key result areas. So first, you need to translate your vision. Now vision is what? What is the vision? Can you please tell me what is the vision? You please. No, him. I'm asking him. Okay, anybody else? Vision is a dream, but translating vision into a goal. Goal is what? Your short-term, medium-term, which is goal is specific. Goal is measurable. Goal is attainable. Goal is time-bound. And goal is realistic. Say, I want to be, suppose XYZ company, I want to be 10,000 crore company within, say, 20 years. That's my goal. And these are my aspirations. These are my objectives. These objectives will be translated. I need to have a very good employee base, and I need to prove my company as best place to work. These are called the objectives. I need to have a better motivating system or rewards and recognition system that nobody is having in India. So that is called the objective. I need to have that kind of system which is very, very measurable, which will be measuring the performance of people. You know, in US, I worked with a company called Sprint PCS. That monthly appraisal, on 30th you get your incentive. Here, on the quarter end also you don't get your incentive. And our appraisal system is so much theoretical. So you have to make appraisal, you know, very, very practical. So how it is happening, you go to companies like Accenture, Google, or companies like Pepsi, or companies like Cadence, and try to understand how it is happening. Now, all these things are now in enterprise solution, in ERP solution. So you need not to worry about this. You have to facilitate it. But you need to understand what is your role to connect the vision. I'll tell you a story. I think that will suffice your purpose. Two young executives from Harvard Business, they were doing a survey on human behavior at work. They went to London. They met a guy called Jim. And he was basically a drunken drug addict. They asked him a very silly question. Who was your motivator? I said, see, my father was a drunken drug addict. He used to beat my mother. He used to take her ornaments and sell it in the market. But he used to enjoy his life. He was always in the air. So I thought I'll follow my father. And you can say he is my reason, he is my motivation, everything. If you want to ask the same question, I have somebody for you, is my brother. You can see there is a 20-story building on the top floor. He's sitting. Could you please go there and ask him? They went to the elder brother. His name is Philip. They said, Philip, your brother is a drunken drug addict. Your father was a drunken drug addict. Your mother was a cancer patient. How could you make yourself a successful businessman? From where you got your vision? From where you got your motivation? Said my father. I said, how? He was a drunken drug addict. He said, see, I am the eldest son of my family. My father used to beat my mother. My mother was a cancer patient. There was no medication. He used to steal the money and he used to enjoy, he used to drink, he used to take drugs. My younger brother followed his path. And I thought, if I have not served my family, my family will be spoiled. Right? Then he said, I started a small business, but I knew where I want to be. But my target was, I'm forgetting the company name. He was the pioneer in Y2K program. He showed them the diary that every day his homework was what is his next day target and what he has done, what he is supposed to do. Then he said, please go to my employees. Then you get to know how this vision has been transformed. They went to employees. On each and every employee's pin board, the target of the month and the goal of the year was attached. So everybody knew that what is his vision, promoter's vision, and what is their vision. So this is called vision translation. And if you people could do this, there's a big job for you. HR Process Transformation, HPT. This is an upcoming tool which is replacing your existing HR programs or existing HR operations. Now recruitment is replaced by talent acquisition. Now you people must be knowing what is the difference between recruitment and talent acquisition. Can anybody attempt? Can anybody attempt, please? Anybody else? the company doesn't say recruitment. In recruitment, you bring in people for a position. But when you bring in a talent, not for one position, you bring in a talent and nurture the talent for the future. Do you get my point? Now, in a recruitment, what you do, you don't do talent mapping. You don't do, talent gap analysis. You don't do talent fitment. What you do is, you just take a job description and you see the competencies and you interview a person or evaluate a person and give him a job. This is a recruitment. But talent acquisition starts much before that and it goes much ahead of that. Talent acquisition start from talent planning. Now 3 years ahead or 5 years ahead, where you want to be, your organization, where it will be. Now the person you are recruiting today, what kind of capability he will be having that he can be promoted to that level? So that is called, talent scaling. First is talent gap analysis. You need to understand what kind of talent you have, what is your talent inventory, and where is the talent gap. Now, after getting the talent gap, you induct that talent into the company and you prepare growth path. So starting from talent gap analysis, starting from talent mapping, talent gap analysis, talent allocation, and talent development is the entire process of talent acquisition. Now, talent acquisition is upgraded. So, talent acquisition is upgraded into competency-based talent acquisition. So, there is a scorecard which is being used in competency-based talent acquisition. Now, what is that? Your job role is broken into, X number of job competencies and behavioral competencies, which is called competency dictionary. And on the basis of the dictionary, when you interview a candidate, you need to score the competencies, which is called competency scorecard. So that is called fitment. Now, induction is being replaced by onboarding. Can anybody? If you are not interested, because I cannot go beyond without discussing. And really, to be very frank, either I'm very worried or you don't have the interest to discuss. I'm not an academic expert. I'm from experience. So please ask me questions. Get into the discussion, you'll enjoy. Yeah. See, employee has different aspirations. Now, employees, when they join into organization, what exactly we do? The newer HR or the recent HR, what they do exactly? They should put them into a purpose. They should bring them into a purpose which is closer to organization vision. So vision has to be translated into an organizational purpose, and organizational purpose has to be translated or to be connected to the aspiration. Now there are a lot of negative and positive aspiration of individuals, those who join the companies. Now you have to bend them in so that they can see or they can foresee a growth path. Now unless and until you do that, they get fed up. Now first of all, I'll tell you how employees get fed up. You recruit employees, the day one he joined over here and he doesn't have a job role to play, he doesn't have activity chart, he doesn't know what to do, he doesn't know what is his role for achieving the vision of the company. So what will happen is, suppose you bring him as a recruiter and the HR manager saw, you know, there is a need for performance management. So he'll ask, would you please do the performance management? He will start doing, because he got a job, he will serve a job. He start doing the performance management system. He is not a person of performance management system. He is a person of recruitment. Right. So what happens? His aspiration got troubled. He get into a different job. Then, you know, he passed 3 months, 6 months, he didn't get a goal set. He didn't get his care. He gets frustrated. Then what he does? Till the time he didn't get a job, he will make others dissatisfied. And till the time he didn't get a job, he will create a lot of problems in the company. The second thing is, he doesn't have care. So whatever he does, he's getting his salary, he's getting his incentive, he's working, he's fine. And the day he gets a job, he moves on. So the main problem is, we are always looking at operation. We are not looking at how to transform the vision into operation, how to transform the vision into care, or vision into activity. When we can do that, then everybody is committed to a job. Now, in India, you go to any factory, you go to any company, you get to know 70% of people, they don't have their care. And if some people, they have care, every day their care changes. So we have to get out of that mindset that HR is this. So we have to have a paradigm shift. I hope my question is, my answer is clear to you. So exit T&D. T&D, training and development, and is replaced by L&D, learning and development. Now, you must be knowing what is the difference between T&D and L&D. I'll not ask you. Okay. Exit is replaced by offboarding. And, employee life cycle is modified by talent management system, and manpower planning is modified by talent planning. Now, here also I'm going to answer some of your queries, that people, they come with different aspirations. They don't work. Because either they are highly supervised or they are not given time to think. They are not given the space to create. So now, the hierarchy or the organization structure as per industry is getting restructured. So what happens is, when technology comes in, the business model, you know, gets refined, and you have a lot of dysfunctional workflow, dysfunctional portfolios. So now new companies are saying, now companies like Google, companies like IBM, they say every year you should do restructure. Every year or every alternate year you should do restructure. And you need to understand what kind of structure you are going to adopt. Is it a metric structure? Is it a flat structure? Is it a pyramid structure? Which structure you are going to adopt? So many a time what is happening in a project-based organization, people are adopting metric structure, and in a metric structure, what happens? A person is reporting to 2-3 people. So in a project organization, metric structure is applicable. But in IT industries, generally they are adopting flat structure. They give people ample authority or empowerment to think and create. In a factory kind of atmosphere, you cannot think and create. But in a lab kind of atmosphere, you can think and create, and that is being adopted by new HR process. HR is not HR is not going to be a support function anymore. In forthcoming years, HR is going to be a line function. And HR executive needs to analyze business process. HR is going to be the frontline executive along with the CXOs in future. And they need to understand the business criticality, which is not happening today. So now the HR analyst or the HR experts are going to lead the flock. So industry is taking the turn. Now there is a big need of strategic HR people. And if you people are ready, there is a big job for you. If you people are only concentrating on operation, there is no job for you. Maybe 2 to 3 years. I'm not here to discourage you. But what I'm trying to tell you is the truth. Make a bent up mind of strategic transformation. You have a big career in future. If you have a, if you are only focusing, analysis of data, Excel sheet, payroll, PMS, this job is going to lapse within 2 to 3 years. They need to design a strategy in line with business goal, as I told you. All strategies will be driven by the business goal. First, you as a person, the day you join an organization, you need to understand what is a business goal and what is your own goal and where you are congruating both the goals. You as an HR executive, your role is, first and prime role is to make employees understand what they are for in the company, what is their goal for the company, what is company's goal, and where they are going to see themselves after 5 years, 3 years, or 10 years. That is your main job. You are going to be a system which is fully smart. I repeated many times what is smart. Can anybody attempt what is smart?
Sustainable, measurable, attainable, and time-bound.
Now, how you will fulfill the aspiration, because everybody has different aspirations. Now you have to connect aspirations with business goal. You have to connect aspiration with purpose. Then only you can enable and you can facilitate employees to do something. Now, there is a big question. Now, where I think the discussion is revolving around. Now, what is that smart work you people are going to do? First is, you have a goal of life, right? Now, how that goal is congruating with organization goal? First is, you have to break the vision into goal, functional goal, or functional strategies, and translate strategies into objectives, and objectives into key result areas, which is the biggest challenge of HR people. Even if you go to many companies, all the people or all the employees, they must not be in their KRS, key result areas. So first, you need to translate your vision. Now, vision is what? What is a vision? Can you please tell me what is a vision? You please. No, him. I'm asking him. Okay, anybody else? Vision is a dream, but translating vision into a goal. Goal is what? Your short term, medium term, which is goal is specific. Goal is measurable. Goal is attainable. Goal is time bound. And goal is realistic. Say, I want to be, suppose XYZ company, I want to be 10,000 crore company within, say, 20 years. That's my goal. And these are my aspirations. These are my objectives. These objectives will be translated. I need to have a very good employee base, and I need to prove my company as best place to work. These are called the objectives. I need to have a better motivating system or rewards and recognition system that nobody is having in India. So that is called the objective. I need to have that kind of system which is very, very measurable, which will be measuring the performance of people. You know, in US, I worked with a company called Sprint PCS. They have monthly appraisal. On 30th, you get your incentive. Here, on the quarter end also, you don't get your incentive. And our appraisal system is so much theoretical. So you have to make appraisal, you know, very, very practical. So how it is happening, you go to companies like Accenture, Google, or companies like Pepsi, or companies like Cadence, and try to understand how it is happening. Now, all these things are now in enterprise solution, in ERP solution. So you need not to worry about this. You have to facilitate it. But you need to understand what is your role to connect the vision. I'll tell you a story. I think that will suffice your purpose. Two young executives from Harvard Business, they were doing a survey on human behavior at work. They went to London. They met a guy called Jim. And he was basically a drunken drug addict. They asked him a very silly question. Who was your motivator? I said, see, my father was a drunken drug addict. He used to beat my mother. He used to take her ornaments and sell it in the market. But he used to enjoy his life. He was always in the air. So I thought I'll follow my father. And you can say he is my vision, he is my motivation, everything. If you want to ask the same question, I have somebody for you, is my brother. You can see there is a 20-storied building on the top floor. He's sitting. Could you please go there and ask him? They went to the elder brother. His name is Philip. They said, Philip, your brother is a drunken drug addict. Your father was a drunken drug addict. Your mother was a cancer patient. How could you make yourself a successful businessman? From where you got your vision? From where you got your motivation? Said my father. I said, how? He was a drunken drug addict. He said, see, I am the eldest son of my family. My father used to beat my mother. My mother was a cancer patient. There was no medication. He used to steal the money, and he used to enjoy, he used to drink, he used to take drugs. My younger brother followed his path. And I thought, if I will not serve my family, my family will be spoiled. Right? Then he said, I started a small business, but I knew where I want to be. But my target was, I'm forgetting the company name, he was the pioneer in Y2K program. He sold them the diary that every day his homework was what is his next target and what he has done, what he is supposed to do. Then he said, please go to my employees. Then you get to know how this vision has been transformed. They went to employees. On each and every employee's pin board, the target of the month and the goal of the year was attached. So everybody knew that what is his vision, promoter's vision, and what is their vision. So this is called vision translation. And if you people could do this, there's a big job for you. HR Process Transformation, HPT. This is an upcoming tool which is replacing your existing HR programs or existing HR operations. Now, recruitment is replaced by talent acquisition. Now, you people must be knowing what is the difference between recruitment and talent acquisition. Can anybody attempt? Can anybody attempt, please? Anybody else? You bring in a talent and nurture the talent for the future. Do you get my point? Now, in a recruitment, what you do, you don't do talent mapping. You don't do, talent gap analysis. You don't do talent fitment. What you do is, you just take a job description and you see the competencies and you interview a person or evaluate a person and give him a job. This is a recruitment. But talent acquisition starts much before that and it goes much ahead of that. Talent acquisition starts from talent planning. Now 3 years ahead or 5 years ahead where you want to be, your organization, where it will be. Now the person you are recruiting today, what kind of capability he will be having that he can be promoted to that level. So that is called, talent scaling. First is talent gap analysis. You need to understand what kind of talent you have, what is your talent inventory, and where is the talent gap. Now, after getting the talent gap, you induct that talent into the company and you prepare growth path. So starting from talent gap analysis, starting from talent mapping, talent gap analysis, talent allocation, and talent development is the entire process of talent acquisition. Now, talent acquisition is upgraded. So talent acquisition is upgraded into competency-based talent acquisition. So there is a scorecard which is being used in competency-based talent acquisition. Now what is that? Your job role is broken into, X number of job competencies and behavioral competencies, which is called competency dictionary. And on the basis of the dictionary, when you interview a candidate, you need to score the competencies, which is called competency scorecard. So that is called fitment. Now, induction is being replaced by onboarding. Can anybody? If you are not interested, because I cannot go beyond without discussion. And really, to be very frank, either I'm very boring or you don't have the interest to discuss. I'm not an academic expert. I'm from experience. So please ask me questions. You know, get into the discussion, you'll enjoy. Yeah. See, employee has different aspirations. Now, employees, when they join into organization, you know what exactly we do? The newer HR or the recent HR, what they do exactly? They should put them into a purpose. They should bring them into a purpose which is closer to organization vision. So vision has to be translated into an organizational purpose, and organizational purpose has to be translated or to be connected to the aspiration. Now there are a lot of negative and positive aspiration of individuals, those who join the companies. Now you have to bring them in so that they can see or they can foresee a growth path. Now unless and until you do that, they get fed up. Now first of all, I'll tell you how employees get fed up. You recruit employees. The day one, he joined over here and he doesn't have a job role to play. He doesn't have activity chart. He doesn't know what to do. He doesn't know what is his role for achieving the vision of the company. So what will happen is, suppose you bring him as a recruiter and the HR manager saw, you know, there is a need for performance management. So he will ask, would you please do the performance management? He will start doing, because he got a job, he will save a job. He start doing the performance management system. But he is not a person of performance management system. He is a person of recruitment. Right? So what happens? His aspiration got troubled. He get into a different job. Then, you know, he passed 3 months, 6 months, he didn't get a goal seat. He didn't get his care. He gets frustrated. Then what he does? Till the time he didn't get a job, he will make other dissatisfied. And till the time he didn't get a job, he will create a lot of problems in the company. The second thing is, he doesn't have care. So whatever he does, he's getting his salary, he's getting his incentive, he's working, he's fine. And the day he gets a job, he moves on. So the main problem is, we are always looking at operation. We are not looking at how to transform the vision into operation, how to transform the vision into care, or vision into activity. When we can do that, then everybody is committed to a job. Now, in India, you go to any factory, you go to any company, you get to know 70% of people, they don't have their care. And if some people, they have care, every day their care changes. So, we have to get out of that mindset that HR is this. So we have to have a paradigm shift. I hope my question is, my answer is clear to you. So exit T&D, training and development is replaced by L&D, learning and development. Now, you must be knowing what is the difference between PND and LND. I'll not ask you. Okay. Exit is replaced by offboarding. And, employee life cycle is modified by talent management system, and manpower planning is modified by talent planning. Now, here also I'm going to answer some of your queries, that people, they come with different aspirations. They don't work. Because either they are highly supervised or they are not given time to think. They are not given the space to create. So now the hierarchy or the organization structure as per industry is getting restructured. So what happens is, when technology comes in, the business model, gets refined, and you have a lot of, dysfunctional workflow, dysfunctional portfolios. So now new companies are saying, now companies like Google, companies like IBM, they say every year you should do restructure. Every year or every alternate year you should do restructure. And you need to understand what kind of structure you are going to adopt. Is it a matrix structure? Is it a flat structure? Is it a pyramid structure? Which structure you are going to adopt? So many a time what is happening in a project-based organization, people are adopting matrix structure, and in a matrix structure, what happens? A person is reporting to 2-3 people. So in a project organization, matrix structure is applicable. But in IT industries, generally, they are adopting flat structure. They give people ample authority or empowerment to think and create. In a factory kind of atmosphere, you cannot think and create. But in a lab kind of atmosphere, you can think and create, and that is being adopted by new HR process. HR is not HR is not going to be a support function anymore. The forthcoming years, HR is going to be a line function. And HR executive needs to analyze business process. Jo aaj nahi ho raha. HR is going to be the frontline executive along with the CXOs in future. Jo aaj nahi ho raha. And they need to understand the business criticality, which is not happening today. So now the HR analysts or the HR experts are going to lead the flock. So industry is taking the turn. Now there is a big need of strategic HR people. And if you people are ready, there is a big job for you. If you people are only concentrating on operation, there is no job for you. Maybe 2 to 3 years. I'm not here to discourage you. But what I'm trying to tell you is the truth. Make a mental mind of strategic transformation. You have a big career in future. If you have if you are only focusing, analysis of data, Excel sheet, payroll, PMS, this job is going to lapse within 2 to 3 years. They need to design HR strategy in line with business goal, as I told you. All strategies will be driven by the business goal. First, you as a person, the day you join an organization, you need to understand what is a business goal and what is your own goal and where you are congruating both the goals. You as an HR executive, your role is, first and prime role is to make employees understand what they are four in the company. What is their goal for the company? What is company's goal? And where they are going to see themselves after 5 years, 3 years, 10 years? That is your main job. You are going to be a system which is fully smart. I repeated many times what is smart. Can anybody attempt what is smart?
Sustainable, measurable, attainable, and
time-bound. Whatever you are going to do, whatever you are going to do is going to be measured, which is specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and time-bound. So every job, now, jo conventional HR kar raha hai, you are not going to do that. So all of your jobs are going to be measured. All of your jobs are going to be realistic. All of your jobs are going to be time-bound. So try to understand, you are in an AS, which AS is very much realistic. And you are going to do no theoretical jobs. You are going to do all realistic jobs. You should be goal-oriented, linked to business strategy. I was talking to a friend of mine. He's a CXO, he's a CEO of a company in Michigan. He runs a company having around 1,200 people. Whenever he gets into the work, he's a owner of a software company. So whenever he gets into the workflow, workflow, anybody he meets, he asks, what is your vision and what is company's vision? If that person doesn't answer, he asked him to go. I asked, why do you do these silly things? He said, oh, you don't understand. If my goal is not transformed and translated to his goal, he's wasting my time and his time. First of all, when a person joins in the onboarding program, he himself takes the onboarding program. He teaches. He's an Indian. He teaches what I want from you people, what my vision is, and what is your goal. And even after that, if he asks somebody and the person cannot tell him that what exactly is company wanting from him, after that he said, he's not required. I think somewhere is logical. You need to link business strategy, enabling profitability and productivity. Every time now onwards, HR people will be linked with profitability. Now, I'll show you a video, then I'll finish my lecture. Now, what do you need to do? I think I am very much engrossed in this video. I am very much encouraged by this video. You must have seen this video also, and some of the campaign this video is being used. Now, just take a look.
Sir, आपके लिए उस पर कार का इंतजाम किया है।
Oh,
From small things for a greater purpose. And that is why you are building your career. If this message is not come to you, goodbye.